An hour's drive from Jordan's capital of Amman, this family-owned pastry shop called Farouk Sweets looks like a typical Middle Eastern bakery. Customers stock up on pastries for the weekend. In the back, five bakers are busy filling large wedding orders. What's unusual is that this shop is inside Zataari, the largest Syrian refugee camp in the world, spread over 3 square miles of desert. Opened by the Jordanian government and the United Nations in 2012, Zataari lies just across the border with Syria. 80,000 people used to live in tents and now live in shelters made from corrugated metal containers called caravans.
When they first arrived, refugees thought it would be for just a few weeks, maybe a month. But that stay has lasted longer than anyone expected, 5 years and counting. Even though they're less than 10 miles from home, refugees have had to recreate their lives here.
That means, for many, opening up small businesses just like they did back home. The pastry shop is one of 3,000 businesses inside the camp. Many line the main road. There's a supermarket, a pizza place, a falafel stand, a gardening shop, and a store to rent bridal gowns. Abu Amena M. Abu Husseini and his four brothers own Farouk Sweets.
There is good opportunity to work here. Thursday, Friday, and Monday are busiest because at that time they're celebrating weddings.
His family abandoned their chain of bakeries when they fled their besieged hometown of Dara in southern Syria. Two-thirds of the refugees in Zataari are also from there. Abu Husseini and some 24 relatives have opened 4 shops inside the camp. Their business is about financial and psychological survival.
We get up every morning at 6 o'clock to escape the situation we're in. We have to work.
There's a long history of trade between Jordanians and Syrians, cemented by strong family ties. Jordanians have partnered with Syrian refugees, providing them credit and wholesale supplies to start over. In addition to whatever funds they brought with them, the UN provides refugees vouchers to pay for cooking and heating gas, as well as $28 a month per person to pay for food. That's $140 a month for a family of 5. That money helps refugees buy products from shops in the camp. The most popular attract local customers from nearby towns. Some Jordanian partners are even exporting goods produced in the camp.
Jordanians, they come and buy from here. Taxi drivers pick up sweets to take outside, and all the Syrians that live outside the camp for weddings, they make orders and pick up their sweets from here.
According to the UN, businesses inside Zataari generate $13 million a month for the refugees and the Jordanians they do business with. Mohammed Kher Al-Jakhtar opened a barber shop in the camp 2 years ago to support himself and 14 relatives who fled Syria with him.
Ever since it opened, I've had customers, and business has been okay. Nobody can go without a haircut. It's like water and food.
Al-Jakhtar and his family are from Homs, previously Syria's third largest city.
Our house was destroyed, so for us, we have nothing left in Syria.
Initially, Al-Jakhtar and his family settled in Amman 4 years ago, but he couldn't work legally outside the camp then, so he moved to Zataari, where there's free electricity and housing and better opportunities to use his skills.
We need to generate an income. In the camp, you can make some money.
The UN also pays some refugees to do jobs around the camp. Al-Jakhtar paints murals on caravans. Beyond the camps in Jordan's cities, the government has loosened employment restrictions on refugees and is investing in industries Syrians are skilled in: construction, agriculture, manufacturing, and technology. Oasis 500, a Jordanian company that mentors and invests in tech startups, has recruited Syrian entrepreneurs to come to Jordan and participate in their mentoring program. Mo Gashim was one of them. He's from Syria's most populous city, Aleppo. He ran his own web design agency with 12 employees. It was successful until the war.
And things started to become ugly back then in Syria. No electricity, no internet. I couldn't work anymore. I searched for incubators in the Arab world. Amman was basically booming, a lot of startups.
5 years ago, with seed money from Oasis 500, he launched ShopGo, an e-commerce platform helping businesses in the region process payments, something he learned to do in the U.S. while paying his way through college. He now has 300 clients.
We're in Dubai, we're in Amman, we're now subcontracting others. We have subcontractors in UK, subcontractors in US. 4 years ago, I just wanted $10,000. That was it to survive. Yeah, and we raised over $3 million in funding so far.
25 of Gashim's employees are Jordanian, 7 are Syrian. The integrated workforce is intentional.
I'm very proud of how we're trying to work together as a community. The team that work with me brought their family here. Some of them married Jordanians. We have to survive.
Today, Gashim lives in Amman with an office overlooking an upscale shopping mall, building a future for himself, while Aleppo is ravaged by war.
I feel that I'm jumping between these two lives, between two movies, two things that you can't relate. I don't belong to this place, but technically I do. And I belong to that place, but technically I don't.
Unlike Gashim, not every Syrian refugee has the skills, the capital, or the connections to support themselves. Jordan's government contends refugees are depleting a quarter of its annual budget, draining resources like water and overcrowding hospitals and schools. In Mafraq, the city closest to the Zaatari refugee camp, the population has doubled to 200,000. The High Al Dubat School for Girls has shortened class times and lengthened school days to accommodate Syrian children. Jordanian kids come in the morning and Syrians in the afternoon. Alia Akusheda is the principal.
Sometimes the Jordanians feel that the Syrians are coming in and taking their seats, their desks.
Nationwide, 50,000 Syrian children are on waiting lists to attend Jordanian schools. In addition to double shifts, Akusheda says she and her staff are dealing with many Syrian kids traumatized by war.
They were very aggressive at first. They were very violent, and they would break things, benches, windows. But now they are a lot calmer. We were patient with them.
Jordan is committed to educating refugee children, says Imad Fakhouri, Jordan's Minister of Planning and International Cooperation.
We in Jordan, for example, very early on believed that we cannot afford to have a lost Syrian generation. Syrian boys and girls that don't go for schools for 5, 6, 7, 10 years, they'll be left vulnerable to radicalization.
Jordan has received $1.5 billion from the European Union, with another $4 billion in international aid pledged to help Syrian refugees. Minister Fakhouri believes the EU is essentially paying Jordan to keep refugees in Jordan.
The reality is, I think we are at a saturation point. We're fatigued as a nation. You can count on a country of Jordan to do this for 5 years, but this is the sixth year. There's no end in sight. It will take years before the refugees can go back safely. Enough is enough. The international community needs to do much more. You can't wait. It costs you 10 times when the refugees get into Europe. So why not do more at the host country's point of view?
Fakhouri believes more aid is needed to fulfill the idea that if the lives of Syrian refugees improve in Jordan, they'll be less likely to migrate to Europe.
We're very much interested that the Syrians remain close to their country, that they will have the chance one day to go back and build it and reconstruct it.
That's exactly what Abu al-Mena'em Abu Hassani and his brothers want to do once the war ends.
Right away, we will go back, and in this place, we'll sell. But we will not stay here a minute longer.